We'll just, I'll start by asking both of them one question each, and then maybe we can open it up to the floor as well. I know we're running a little late, so we're going to try and keep this as crisp as possible as well. You've already been introduced to the speaker, so I will, for the benefit of time, not go into the introductions once again. But Ms. Stern, if I can ask with you, Dr. Stern, you talked about, you know, in terms of unlocking the India-US trade potential, and you talked about America pulling out of the TPP, the Indo-Pacific that Secretary Tillerson has spoken about recently as well, where India is the western flank of the Indo-Pacific and the United States is the eastern flank. There is, however, a sense in India, even amongst the foreign policy establishment, that when the United States is talking in this language, as beneficial as it may be in the larger scheme of things, the prism is a little narrow. It is about looking at India as a counterweight specifically to China. Is there a way to step beyond just that singular role for India, in your view?
Oh, I think there should be a role. We in the United States, historically, since World War II, have been very used to thinking in blocks. Mm-hmm. As you know, post-World War II, we had the need to deal with the Soviet bloc in the Comecon countries. And so much of our trade agreements were often pursuant to this geopolitical reality of the Soviet challenge. Mm-hmm. The implosion, frankly, of the Soviet Union, I think, is one of the biggest contributors to the lack of or diminishing support for trade agreements in the United States. In other words, we don't have this common enemy, which makes it so easy to get the American public around engagement with the rest of the world. So it's a challenge. And the US needs to be very cognizant of the extraordinarily distinct position that India holds in the world. It's a subcontinent. It's going to be the world's largest at one soon population in the world, certainly the most important of the middle class. And it has had a magnificent history, which has nothing to do, if you will, with the way the U.S. has fought about the world the last 70 years. So our public and our leadership need to be guiding our public thinking to appreciate how India casts its dramatically significant shadow, mm-hmm. not only in the past, but will so in the future. It is a huge challenge. It has nothing, India was, of course, for many years, representing the, if you will, the third world and the non-alignment, et cetera, and it did rely quite a bit on assistance from the Soviet Union. But that is minor compared to this dramatic civilization that India represents.
And just as a follow-up to that question before I take it to Mr. Nilekani as well, do you think that this idea of the Indo-Pacific that is now being talked about can be a viable alternative to the TPP, because people, member states of the TPP who are anxious about America's withdrawal are now looking to America to see what's the next big thing that will also protect their interests. So while you have the Indians sort of saying, we don't only want to be a counterweight to China, we have a greater role, you also have other member states of the TPP saying, hey, what about us?
Well, I didn't come here to solve all the problems of the world. I was thinking really mostly about India. But as you know, the 11 nations that remain of the TPP negotiating groups, minus the United States, are doing quite well negotiating amongst themselves. And we will be seeing, I think, some results pretty soon with regard to that. I believe that is a challenge which the Trump administration will have to face. My role today was to try to offer, if you will, to the Trump administration a path out of some of the conundrum, conundra, is that the plural, that may have been created in the last 10 months.
Okay, all right. We'll definitely open the floor up to questions for Dr. Stern as well. Nandan Nilekani, let me just jump right in because you opened the way for this question when you were speaking just now. You talked about data and data being the pathway to innovation, pathway to developing better trade relations with the United States, but linked to the conversations on the unique identification number and sort of the positive aspects of it as far as social inclusion or financial inclusion are concerned, are concerns about security and how data can be misused. There is a perception, and maybe you can address it, of the India stack, as you mentioned, being extremely porous. And when you're talking about that stack being available to other companies and private sector, etc., it sort of raises the question about who's going to be using these biometrics, what is going to be used for, how much of it is going to be secure and within the control of the owner of those biometrics.
Well, actually, it's not only very secure. I think people need to really understand what is happening. What you have is just an ID system. It's not accumulating data about anybody. And it only does a validation of the ID. So it, when you go and use it, you basically say, I'm Maya, and the system confirms that you're Maya. And that is called as digital authentication. And whether we have to realize that today in a digital world, the ability of people to identify themselves in a very secure way to who, whatever the other system, is a very, very important infrastructure which India has built. So it's really critical to how you do things. It's a very secure system, and the way it's used is also in a very secure way. There is no data that is exchanged, there's no data that is given, and it is designed as a platform for both public and private innovation. And you have to think about how technology platforms have evolved in the world. The two biggest platforms in the last 60 years have both been built by the United States. One is the internet platform, the other is GPS. Both were built by US DOD. They were driven by security concerns, but finally these platforms have become available to the common person. So the internet was up till about 1995 really used for defense, academic kind of thing, but with the rise of Netscape and other, and now with other internet companies, today it's a thriving innovation ecosystem. Similarly, when you look at GPS, GPS was designed by US Department of Defense, Star Wars, all that. But in the year 2000, in the Clinton administration, it was put for commercial use. And today, the fact that you have things like maps and all these Uber and all that is because GPS has been made available, right?
Right.
So all that Aadhaar does is answer the question, who am I? And allows you to verify that online. So when somebody uses that, they're just using it to confirm an identity, and then they get on with their work. So there's absolutely no, I think this is all hogwash.
Okay, you mentioned also in your remarks about the Supreme Court judgment on privacy that I think was trying to address some of these concerns as well, even as it hears a case on Aadhaar. You said that the Supreme Court's judgment also looked at ways where, you know, privacy, while it's a fundamental right, could be circumscribed for social inclusion. I think one of the concerns, and this is globally across the world, when we look at data, when we're looking at the big sort of tech giants in the world as well, and what they are doing with the user data we give them when we click on terms and agreements and you know, accept community standards without reading all the fine print. Is there a concern that social inclusion could then sort of become political profiling? I mean, just yeah,
again, I think
this
yeah. comes from a lack of understanding of the design of what yeah. is there. And I don't know whether on Indo-US trade we need to discuss these things.
Well, I think this is something that's come up in the United States as well, because
discuss,
tech companies
anyway,
in the US are dealing with
yeah.
this question right now.
Yeah, so let me explain that, first of all, the judgment of the US, Indian Supreme Court was a conceptual framework mm-hmm. on how to think about privacy in a modern age.
Hmm.
Right? They said that privacy is a fundamental right.
Yeah.
However, the state can circumscribe privacy for the following four reasons: for national security, for protection of revenue, for social welfare, and for criminal activities. And they have accepted that digital innovation is a key part of the future of the world. So all that is very good. Now, that's a general framework. Now, there's going to be a separate bench of the Supreme Court, 3 to 5 judge bench, which is going to look at Aadhaar in specific, whether it meets that. So that's a separate conversation.
Right.
But I think we have to obviously have a very good framework for data. And the Aadhaar system is not a collector of data. This, you must understand the difference, that when you talk about companies that collect data, it doesn't collect any data.
Mm.
It is used by other people for verification. So when the banking system uses Aadhaar, it uses Aadhaar to verify. The data remains with the bank. When the healthcare system uses Aadhaar, it uses Aadhaar to verify, but the healthcare records remain with the healthcare system. This is what is called as a federated architecture.
Mm.
So that's the heart of it. So I think we tend to think that everything is all going to one place. It's not. It's all going to its respective place.
But it's linked to one number.
It's linked to one number, which in turn could be a number or it could be a tokenized number. So there are ways to deal with that.
Okay. Dr. Stern, in one of your roles, you're also looking at the role of women in
yes.
information technology.
Yes.
And Mr. Nilekani was making the point as he began his speech about, you know, presence-less, paperless, people-less sort of
cashless, people are very much there.
People are,
we're still in there.
Yeah, we're still right there, exactly. But you know, in terms of, there's a conversation on reskilling that's taking place in India.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, the need to get people to learn new skills, to adapt to these new kinds of technology that are being used, how this can be used for trade going forward. When you see women in technology
yes.
in these areas, do you think that there is some sort of a way that these various imperatives can come together for India and the United States to then collaborate on further as well? You know, bring gender rights into the equation, bring STEM work into the equation, reskilling, employment. These are questions and conversations happening globally right now.
Well, you've answered your question and done it very, very well. Yes, I am senior advisor to an organization called the National Center for Women and Information Technology, which the National Science Foundation set up in the United States, recognizing about a decade ago that, oh my gosh, we do not have enough computer scientists, information, individual skill in information technology. And it's going to be getting worse if you look at the projections regarding the dynamic needs and opportunities of the future. And that needed to be a doubling down on the half of the U.S. population, which happens to be female.
Mm-hmm.
We were in the United States going backwards. We had more women in computer science, and we were losing them because of a variety of cultural reasons, starting with the very beginning with biases and ignoring the realities of the need to be teaching in the K-12 sectors computing principles, computer science, even having it in our curriculum in the United States, and that problem continued because of biases
right.
culturally, which exist in the United States, as other countries as well, I would add, with regard to discouraging women, isolating them such that when they became a decreasing portion of, for example, a classroom once they got into college,
mm-hmm.
Felt really out of it. And were discouraged ultimately. And even those who finally made their way with a degree in computer science would enter the corporate world. And we found a dropout rate for women in the mid-level, the corporate world, in tech at twice the level of men. And they were dropping out mostly from corporations, not out of tech. They were going into not-for-profit, into government and elsewhere, again, where the culture was better. So we have been involved at the NCWIT is what we call it. In pulling together, we now have 1,000 different organizations, corporations, not-for-profits, academic institutions, growing all the time, to be a community of change leaders to literally change our culture with regard to inclusion of women and underrepresented minorities, so that we tap in to what are skills and opportunities that we can't even imagine will come out of it. What would happen if women were participating in an equal level with men in creating these new technologies that you have been describing so dramatically? What questions would be asked? What solutions would we be generating? We don't know,
right,
because we have never run that experiment.
Is that something that you think Indian companies could help collaborate on, Mr. Nilekani?
Absolutely. You know, I think certainly I can say that there's been a significant increase in the number of women working in technology companies in India. And and even if you look at the engineering colleges now, the number of women studying there is much big. It's almost doubled or tripled from, say, 20 years back. And there's also a lot of activity on the professional front. I mean, there's something called the Grace Hopper Society, which is a U.S. thing to commemorate Grace Hopper, was the first, you know, lady who was in the tech world. And they have a very active chapter in Bangalore. And they're looking at issues of how to get women to be involved. So I think it's a big area, and I think it's happening.
So is this something that, you know, would become, in a sense, for the last couple of decades, the greatest export that India had as far as the United States was concerned was the labor force in the IT sector. There was, you know, that was the story. The people going there, working in these jobs, things like that. Do you think that when you talk about reskilling, bringing women into the workforce, increasing the labor force, increasing opportunities, collaborating on technology, this today can be India's number one export to the rest of the world?
Well, I don't know about number one, but but I think there's a thing here, which is that what firms have learned is how do we create an adaptable workforce where with rapid anytime, anywhere, just-in-time learning infrastructure, they can learn new things and deploy it for their customers. And that's like a core competence that is here. And that competence now is becoming globally applicable, because what's happening around the world is that the technologies are changing very rapidly, and people's historical skills are getting obsoleted in some sense.
Right.
And therefore, you can't rest on your laurels of something you learned way back in college or even 5 years back, because everything's changed. And therefore, you need a new paradigm of learning, which is that you have to be a lifelong learner. You have to be, adapting. And you don't yet know what is it that you need to know, because you don't know what's coming.
So I think the point is that
that ability to create a rapidly adaptable workforce is a capability which we have, which now can be used globally.
As a corollary to that, and I think this links the questions I was asking both of you right in the beginning. Mr. Nilekani, we talk in Indian foreign policy, the circles, you hear constantly about the One Belt, One Road project and the threat of Chinese expansionism in the region. I started off with asking Dr. Stern about, you know, India not wanting to always be in this role of being a counterweight to China. Is digital connectivity that India can offer perhaps the answer to China's One Belt, One Road physical connectivity? I mean, is that something we can think of as an idea?
I don't know if they realize, but in One Belt, One Road, they're also building an extraordinarily digital platform. So you should be aware of that. But anyway, it's probably the most widespread use of blockchain for supply chain applications.
Okay.
So they are thinking about digital and physical. But coming back to India, yes, I think India has a role. thanks to the last decade or so where India has built very sophisticated technology infrastructure for a billion people to transact and, you know, participate in society, that know-how is very, very globally relevant. And so I'm a member of the World Bank High Level Policy on Identity. We had a meeting 3 weeks back in the Washington as part of the IMF World Bank, and we had a meeting with about 15 countries who all wanted to learn from this experience. So I think, yes, there is a dimension of that the digital infrastructure that India has created has global applicability.
Okay. I think we have about 10 minutes for questions. We already have hands up. Can I ask you to please keep your questions brief, pointed, and a quick one-word introduction of yourself when you're asking the question? I saw one hand, second hand here, and the third here. So let's just take, should we take the questions together and then address it? Do you want them one by one?
Whatever.
Yeah. So we'll take the three questions together and then, one, two, and three over here. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Choko Valiapa. Met Paula and Nandan, of course. Paula had alluded to having a bilateral agreement, and Nandan, you had spoken about India being a free economy. So, you know, China didn't allow Amazon, so they had Alibaba, and similarly with their own version of Uber, for example. And then if that wasn't there, and then WhatsApp and WeChat, if India didn't allow that, what would be the size of what we are sharing with America, and how can that be leveraged in a bilateral agreement? Because China seems to be a more manufacturing huge country, whereas India is, like you said, in the technology side. So just trying to ask the question, what would your answer be to Paula's bilateral agreement?
Okay, we'll just take one more question here. Go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, the question to Sir Nilekani, just to understand the dynamic workforce which we are talking about, right? So we are just talking about if we get the dynamic workforce who can just ready to just learn and then quickly just do about it, can we bring a framework where we, because the challenges now 40 plus are finding it difficult because of the learning capability in there, so there is an unemployment, and even the youngsters are not able to get because of the future technology. Is there a way where, since you're just talking about bringing the dynamic workforce as a way forward to celebrate or create a more indoor trade potential opportunity, can you show some light on how do we make it further as a framework?
The dynamic workforce. And one more question here. Can you just hand the mic? Thank you. Oh, you've got a mic. All right.
My name is K. Ravi, president of FKCCI. Sir, I have two questions. One is regarding the linking of UID to bank accounts. There's a big hue and cry. What is your opinion about that? Number two, with artificial intelligence, with robotics, manufacturing 4.0, there's a feeling that the labor arbitrage, what India has, would be a disadvantage in the future. What is your opinion?
Okay, so...
All for me.
Yes, that's
Paula,
so good.
You need to take some.
I think the first one actually on bilateral trade, both of you can address for sure.
I think we need, when we look at bilateral trade, I think we have to look at all aspects, right? There's trade in goods, where India will be a big buyer and a seller. There's trade in services, which includes people movements. There's trade in technology. There's trade in data. There's access to markets. So I think any conversation of bilateral trade between two countries
has to
take a holistic view of these things. And he's very much right in saying that unlike in China, which has the so-called Great Firewall and creating domestic champions, Alipay, Alibaba, Baidu, Tencent, Didi, all these guys, India's had a very open policy to global
let
companies and which is why we have such a big presence of Amazon, Google and Facebook. So I think, so when you look at the totality of trade, you have to look at all these things. I think that's a very valid point.
And Dr. Stern, is that something you would want to see in a bilateral trade agreement? Because we talked about the stumbling blocks as well. Maybe some way to navigate through all this?
Very much so. I think we have a head start bilaterally between India and the U.S. to build on Mr. Nilekani's point. and the, what was implicit in the question as well. And I think that what I'm envisioning would be an open-ended, if you will, bilateral tech arrangement, which it would have to be evergreen to reflect the rapidly changing technologies and therefore challenges, as you pointed out very in your speech, that the whole issue of data is one that technologically is rushing ahead before, if you will, both the lawyers can get to it, but these are embedded commercially in contracts. And so we do need to have rules of the road.
And are there any specific areas in bilateral agreements on data that you think could be?
No, there's a whole new, the whole new field. Nobody's right. really.
Okay. The dynamic.
I mean, there's some happening. I mean, the Europe is passing the GDPR next year, which is going to define data sovereignty issues. But it's all nascent stuff. Okay. The Chinese, of course, have just built a wall. So.
The dynamic workforce question that was.
No, I think it's a very good point that I think we need to. I think the challenge that the world faces is as big as the challenge in the previous centuries. I mean, you know, the 19th century was the era of universal education, not in India, mm-hmm. certainly in parts of the world. The 20th century was the era of graduate, you know, massive education, GI Bill, that kind of stuff.
Right.
But this era is going to be about lifelong learning. So mm-hmm. this is a new paradigm. And again, that has not yet been invented.
Okay, and the last question that came from here?
Well, I can't talk about Aadhaar linking and all that. But I think.
But there was a second part to his
but
question.
I think the AI is a very good question. I think.
Yeah.
The way AI is getting positioned by many people is as a job destroyer, which is, I think, not the right way to think about it. The way to think about it in an Indian context is how do you use AI as an amplifier of scarce resources. So you obviously don't have enough teachers to educate a billion people. You don't have enough doctors to serve a billion people. You don't have enough nurses to look after a billion people. And therefore, can we amplify the capability of people using AI? So I think we have to rethink the model, not in terms of elimination of jobs, but amplification of capability.
Okay. All right, we have time for two more questions. One right here, and one all the way in the back. So over here first.
Hi, sir. My name is Ranjit. I'm from Ahana Systems. So I have a, you know, a very important questions, but that I can be, you know, assumed as a dumb asking that question. A few days back, we have seen Facebook shutting down the robots, you know, the chat bots, and you know, since they invented their own language. So if you think, while you know, why can't we let them have their own language, what can you think as a weird future that they can do?
Well, that's a well, I think you know, I mean, this is a big debate. I don't want to get into the debate. I mean, I think there are many people who are cautioning about AI. You know, people like Elon Musk, Bill Gates, Stephen Hawking are all raising questions about AI and whether it needs to be regulated. There are others who say everything is fine. So I think this is a very contentious issue because what, and you know, the recent example is the Alpha, the new Alpha Go from Google taught itself how to play Go as opposed to using data. So you know, there are lots of things happening which we all need to keep track about. I don't think there are easy answer. There are issues of ethical issues. There are bias issues. One of the problems with AI is that the bias of the developer is getting into the, you know, into the AI, and then, you know, it happened with one of the bots. So lots of stuff. I don't want to get into a whole lecture
okay.
on this. But
yeah, can we just take a couple of questions? If they're on trade, I mean, yeah, you have a question on the topic?
Only on trade. Only Indo-US trade.
Indo-US trade.
Way to go.
I like this.
One over here, right there. Okay.
You do all the work.
Yes, my question is to Dr. Stern and Mr. Nandan Nilekani. Dr. Stern spoke of bilateral Indo-US trade cooperation partly being driven by the desire to balance China. Isn't this important to take this to a regional level, as China is looming large in Southeast Asian digital markets with not only e-products but also services like Baidu?
This is similar to the question you asked earlier. I really don't think it's only about balancing China at all. I really do believe that India and the United States have a destiny apart from the issue of the balancing geostrategically with a third power, which is China in this case. And that is really the emphasis that I would like us to imagine today. Every foreign policy of every nation reflects
its
domestic political imperatives, interests, be they business, be they ethnic, be they ideological, and it is that appreciation which I bring to how the United States might in the future shape its foreign policy, particularly with regard to trade. And that's the reason why I was trying to identify new players. And I emphasized the Indian diaspora, which I think has an enormous potential in the United States in shaping how we think of the rest of the world, and in particular India. And I also emphasized new to the table, if you will, for trade negotiations, business sectors, defense trade, and energy trade. Mm. The U.S. has not been an exporter of energy, and they are a huge potential player in helping shape the domestic debate that's going on in the United States, which is very much, if you will, a reflection of the base that President Trump has, which was very skeptical of trade and skeptical of relationships with the rest of the world. And he successfully tapped into that skepticism, and he is a skeptic himself. And I do think that there are ways, if you will, to channel that skepticism and also counter it with new interests that will be more articulate than they have been in the past. An IT sector, which has emerged in the last 20 years, is an enormous
it's been an engine of that
for the future.
Yeah, that's right. And I think, you know, in a sense, asked and answered, because the idea is to also find ways to engage in new areas. And the China question, as much as it is in terms of how Dr. Stern responds to it, I think India is also positioning itself in ways to challenge this in the region. And I think this sort of falls into this paradigm, the Indo-Pacific paradigm that Secretary Tillerson has also talked about. Sir, your question. We make that the last question. Yeah. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm Pradeep Mehta. I head an NGO. My question is to Paula Stern. The last meeting between our trade and industry minister and the U.S. Commerce and USTR, I suppose, at the Trade Policy Forum, which was held in Washington, was a washout.
That's right.
How do you read that in terms of the bilateral trade?
How do you read that? The last meeting of the TPS.
There was no agreements that were announced.
And
just
a
question
to Nandan. Nandan, would you equate free trade with mercantilism? Thank you.
Why don't you go first, Dr. Stern?
Yeah. to answer your question, it was a huge lost opportunity. And being a policy entrepreneur, look around to try to find ways to make, as we say in the United States, lemonade out of lemons. I don't know if that translates in the United States, but lemons are very sour. And then if you figure out how to take that lemon and combine it with other ingredients, you come up with something which is very sweet, like lemonade. And so I believe that we need, and that's what I was trying to provide, was the ingredients, the recipe for US-India lemonade.
You mean sugar?
Well, I would like it to be more substantive and more nutritious than that.
Than sugar. The last question, Anand?
It sounded like some philosophical question, so I don't know what it is. But I think we have to look at all aspects of the equation. I think
we need to have lots more trade, but we need to look at all dimensions, goods, services, data, and have an equitable...
And my last question to both of you, is there any specific area of trade do you think the Indo-US relationship could benefit from focusing on? Because there seem to be so many areas of dissonance, whether it is, you know, dual-use technology or IPR or whatever it is. Talks always sort of end up hitting roadblocks on these specific issues. But any areas that you think are ways to sort of lead into the future and work around the tough stuff later? Dr. Stern?
Well, I tried to emphasize, as I said, those areas in the tech area, picking up perhaps on some of the accomplishments that found their way in the e-commerce area in the TPP, but which now the U.S. not being a part of might be a very first thing. But we're talking about getting the ball rolling. So cybersecurity, we have made enormous leaps and bounds within the security arena, which have major implications for dual use, both civilian and military. And so I put that in there. Tariff reductions, particularly in the IT area, that would be between the US and India, for starters, so that the hesitancy that India has or had in joining the WTO's Information Technology Agreement number two, Roman numeral two, because of the concerns of Chinese imports competing with India, would not be the situation if you started with a US India tariff reduction. So those are, you know, kind of
areas that we could
early harvests.
Okay. Final
question. No, I think, Nandan? See, there's parts of trade which have geopolitical or strategic implications, like nuclear defense. So those will always, government will have a role in it, because there'll be other factors that play beyond market forces.
Mm-hmm.
But the huge part of trade which is market driven, the whole consumer side, tech side, that will grow very fast.